Story 1. Running in the woods. There was a really weird occurrence that happened at my dad's house a few years ago. He awoke to the sound of dogs barking and realized that the neighbor's dogs were barking at something moving in the woods, parallel to the road. When his own dog started to bark, he went outside to see what was up. Across the street is pretty much all forest, except for a church directly across the street. My dad was too far away to see anything, but it was the dead of the night. He could definitely hear the sound of someone running, full tilt, across the gravel lot of the church. A few things freaked him out about this. One, whatever it was definitely running on 2 feet. It was big. Both myself and him have witnessed large animals like bear and moose running through the underbrush. And according to him, it sounded similar in size to those creatures, but on 2 legs. Two, it was easily running somewhere around 40 to 50 miles an hour. It easily cleared the lot and then slowed slightly as it went back into the woods. He was easily able to compare the speed because the road itself is 45 miles an hour. Three, the final thing, its huffing and gasping was loud enough that he could hear it from his door. It was obviously not human. We looked online to compare its sound to other animals, and we didn't really find any sound comparable. The freakiest part was the synchronized reaction of the dogs. He's never heard dogs react like that before. Both him, my stepmom, my stepbrother, and several of our neighbors all can account for hearing the strange barking from all the dogs. But it was only my dad who heard what the dogs were after. Nothing like this has happened since, and I've never personally witnessed anything like it. We live right on the border of the Cascade Mountain Range, and we're surrounded by park and federal land. So, who knows what it was. Story 2. The Flash. My family. Grandpa, Grandma, Mom, a couple aunts, and an uncle went camping at a reservoir in Colorado. The children that was in attendance ranged in age from 1 to 13, with one of my aunts being the eldest, and my uncle, 11 at the time. My mom was 7 or 8. My other aunt was 1. My grandparents would have been in their 30s at the time, and they were camping in a Volkswagen bus. My grandfather was an experienced outdoorsman. Having grown up in a rural area of Illinois during the Depression, growing up, my mom and her siblings took a lot of long camping trips. This particular trip was no different, and it remained routine until the evening my grandfather failed to return from fishing. 9 p.m. rolls around. It's dark. It's super dark out. My family is concerned. My grandfather's never been out this late before. According to my uncle, my older aunt, my grandma decided to drive to the dock, which would be the logical place to begin searching for him. My grandma starts driving around the lake, not realizing that she has made a wrong turn. After 15 minutes or so, my younger aunt starts to fuss. My grandma pulls off the shoulder to check on her. At this point, my mom, my uncle, and my older aunt are looking out the windows. My uncle realizes that they can't see the lake. My grandma gets the one-year-old settled. She gets back behind the wheel. As soon as she fires back up the bus, the oldest 3 kids see hundreds of rabbits running across the ground, away from the left side of the road, the side that will be in view momentarily as grandma makes a 3-point turn. As my grandma completes the first step of the turn, she throws the van in reverse. She realizes that she can't back up because there's a 4-foot ditch behind her and a similar ditch in front of her. She remembers putting the bus in park, and a red light appears in the distance, and the rabbits are scurrying along away from this lot. The light turns white and then red again, and it's sweeping back and forth. It looked like my grandfather's signaling light. He used it often, and my family knew what it was. They're watching this light move back and forth, and something slams into the hood of their bus. Bright white light floods the bus. My grandfather is up all night after returning to the campsite late. He had run into an old friend on the water and stayed out later than he anticipated. He got to camp at midnight and realized that his family was gone. He went to the ranger station and asked for assistance. they searched for them and were preparing to dredge and dive for the vehicle when the bus was spotted on an old service road, 20 miles or so from the lake. My grandfather got there first. He walked to the door, and as soon as he opened it, my grandma fell out of the driver's seat and said, "Oh, thank God you're here." She landed in his arms and began to cry. Her watch, which had been purchased a few months prior to the trip as a birthday gift, had stopped working at 11:15 p.m., corresponding with the flash of light in the van. The kids were sleeping soundly. They had no recollection of the flash. They all get upset when they tell this story, and I get goosebumps every time I hear it. Story 3, Small Town Haunting. This little town has a lot of strange things happening in it. The population hovers around 666. We used to have that on the sign, but the sign either kept having people crash into it or kept getting stolen. So now it reads 667. From September to December, I lived alone in an apartment above a funeral parlor. All was peaceful there for the first little bit. There was only one funeral while I was there. The funeral was sometime in late October, early November. I was alerted that there'd be a funeral in the building, so I left for the weekend. My apartment windows were sealed up tight. I returned on Sunday evening. I found a dozen dead flies on my windowsill, none anywhere else. And that's where the strangeness begins. At first, I started thinking that I was hearing footsteps in the living room at night. I started leaving the living room light on all night. My apartment had no stove, so I had a toaster oven and a microwave. One evening, I'd cooked pizza in the toaster oven. Then I sat and ate my pizza at my computer desk in the bedroom. I've always been very careful to turn my toaster and heating appliances off when not in use. As I ate my pizza, I heard what sounded like glass, drinking glasses, clinking together in the kitchen. But the only drinking glasses in my apartment were plastic. I went to the kitchen to investigate the noise, thinking maybe a mouse was running around. No mouse, but I found the toaster oven was back on. My apartment had electric heat, with a dial in every room to adjust it. I never had electric heat before, and because I was afraid of fire, I never left it on when I wasn't home. One day I came home from work to find my bedroom was warm. I was certain I'd turned the heat off before leaving for work, but the heat was turned on. I had contemplated turning it back off, but because the sun was going down and I knew it would be getting cold in the apartment soon, I left it on. Later that night when I went to bed, the room was ice cold and the heat was turned off again. Another time I left for the week, I double checked to make sure everything was off when I left. I returned home to find the bedroom heat was turned on and my room was toasty warm. Once I woke up in the middle of the night, my eyes were closed, but I was fully conscious. I heard a voice with a Minnesota-type accent say, "Hello there." I laid very still and I thought to myself, I am not going to acknowledge hearing that. I used to listen to a lot of Christian broadcasting on the radio. One night I was listening and the radio reception was clear as a bell. And then a new ministry came on and the topic that night was demons. Suddenly, the radio reception grew increasingly staticky and remained that way until his program ended. Once that show was over, the static left and the radio returned to normal, crystal clear reception. I always kept my winter coat on the back of the desk chair in the front bedroom, where it stayed for 3 weeks because the weather was still warm that fall and I hadn't really needed it yet. I was leaving town for Thanksgiving weekend and I forgot my coat. When I went back to get my coat, it had been moved to the back bedroom. After that, I only went back to that apartment one more time, and that was the day I moved out. When I rented the apartment, my landlord told me that the apartment had been vacant for a year. She said the previous tenant had disappeared and never returned for his belongings. Now I know why. The groundskeeper at the funeral home told me that the assistant funeral director had lived in that apartment. He moved out because things in his apartment kept moving around. They were never where he'd left them. It must take a lot to frighten a funeral director. Story 4, haunted farmhouse. Last year, my mom and I moved to Maine to live with my stepfather and his daughter. I was told we were going to live in an old farmhouse that dated back to the mid-1800s. My stepfather gave me the heads up that the ghost of a farmer that had once lived there still haunted the place, and that his son had saw him walking up the stairs. I was excited to see what I could find out about the house. After getting settled in and getting used to the place, I figured I'd go ghost hunting. I'd heard another story from my stepfather that when his cousin was visiting, he went into the cellar and a light mysteriously turned off on him. Nobody was near the light switch, and him, being afraid of the dark, ran up the stairs. He told my stepfather about it and said that he thought it might have been his deceased wife, who had died that year on Valentine's Day. She had never liked him when she was alive, and was probably playing a prank on him. When I went down to investigate the cellar, I really didn't see anything, and went back upstairs and looked around the place with no luck. One night, when everyone was sleeping, I was in my room on the computer. I looked out into the living room to see a small shadow of a woman looking into my room and walking around the living room. I knew my stepfather's deceased wife from pictures. Her ashes were in the living room. She was most likely just looking over the place, going from room to room, checking everything out. My stepfather's ex-wife was also seen by my mom. She saw a figure walking towards the front door outside, which was where she liked to be when she was alive. My stepfather also saw her as he woke up one morning near the window looking at him. She would communicate with us by moving the wind chime in the living room. Anytime my stepfather mentioned doing any changes to the farmhouse, the wind chime would start shaking. One night when I was brushing my teeth, I felt something poke me in the back of the neck, to the point where it hurt a little bit. But when I turned around, there was no one there. I guess one of the spirits in the house was just trying to get my attention. Eventually, I grew up and got married and moved back to my old hometown. But Mom and my stepdad still live there, and they still experience the ghosts from time to time. I hope you enjoyed the stories. If you did, give me a thumbs up. Hit the subscribe button. I really do appreciate it. Thanks for listening. Bye.